Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Welcome everyone to tonight's meeting. Before we get started, I'd like to ask Commissioner Lashley to give her an invocation.
Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to give thanks to you for all the many blessings you have showered down on us. We just praise your name and lift your name up above all names. And as we do the people's business tonight, we ask for your guidance and directions in everything we say and do. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Bill. Next item on the agenda is public comments, and no one has signed up for that. Is that correct? All right, if not, we'll move on to item number four, which is the Orange Alamance County Line Survey.
Good evening,
Mr. Albright.
Good evening. Good
evening. I wanted to give you an update and let you know that the North Carolina Geodetic Survey group has finished their initial site survey of Alamance County, and they found about 10 points that match up pretty well with the 1849 survey. They are here with us tonight, Gary Thompson, Dennis Lee. They came to answer any questions that you might have. The purpose of this review tonight is just to give you an idea of where we are now and where we're headed. They are going to finish up their survey work, depending on what you tell them to do tonight, and if need be, any changes will be made, and they'll produce a final preliminary survey for the commissioners to approve. If any changes need to be made at that time, and June 30th is their goal for their deadline, and they'll be able to monument the survey pending approval by the Orange County commissioners. Got that little activator there?
Yeah.
Bruce, why don't you come up? Bruce has done a lot of the legwork on this. He's the technical guru here. He's been working with Steve Averett with Orange County, and together, hopefully, we'll have a survey that we can finally put to rest this issue.
Clyde went over a lot of those things. Again, they just finished North Carolina Geodetic Survey. Just finished their initial site survey and gave us 10 points. Again, they base that using USGS quad maps and the 1849 historical survey as their guide. Okay. Just a brief review of what we talked about previous meetings. Some landmarks from the 1849 survey were directly found, and the remaining points were located on the ground using a combination of US quad maps, existing survey plats from both counties around the time of the creation of the US quad maps, and identifying landmarks that are still there today. Original USGS quad maps were created around the beginning of the 20th century and were based on various historical maps, extensive field surveys, and interviews with people on the ground that were there when it first was created in 1849. North Carolina Geodetic Survey presented the results on March 11th to our Alamance Orange County work group. Clyde was there. Again, there was 10 points, and they are already contracted surveyors to make the final preliminary survey. And monument those points if you guys go forward. Upon ratification, of course, with review, the survey will be ratified by the board of this commissioners in both counties, and it'll be recorded at the Office of the Registrar and the Secretary of State's office. If need be, any changes need to be made to it, of course, they can be in the process, and a new final preliminary survey will have to be created to be ratified by both counties. June 30th is the goal and deadline for North County Geodetic Survey because it's the end of their fiscal year. And of course, Gary and Dennis are graciously here to answer any questions you have. I'll go over those 10 points real quickly. Dennis came and had the old topo quad. Some of you from Scouts or something might remember these topo quad maps. And he used that as a base to start. There are 2 points right here, there and there. I transferred them because they did give us GPS points to our GIS to make it a little more easier to understand. This is the northern part of the county, Orange and Alamance. The green area is what we tax to at this point. Our county line is the blue one. Orange County is what they claim is orange. And these points are the ones that the geodetic survey people found. And there's a straight line in between them, it's a black line. This is point number three. Last time we talked a little bit about it, you can see that some areas, this part is taxed in orange all the way, and over here we have one that sticks out over here, and this line is designed to split that up and get everything correct. Here we are in Nevin. 9th Street is the splitting of the line. Orange line has come up here, and our line is almost the same as USGS. We'll go back a step too. You can see in the very beginning, we're over here and there. We kind of converge with the USGS line. Orange is over here. As it goes further down south, the orange line will go to the west. This is just south of I-40. At this point, we're right in line there. There's another point right there. Orange County is to the west at that point. It continues to get further and further apart the further south you go. You scale at the bottom. Of course, you have a copy of everything there. It's about 500 feet at this point on point six. Here we are again. Alamance and the USGS line are very close to each other. And we continue to go down. Here is Cane Creek, where it crosses three times. We talked about that in previous meetings. The Orange County line.
Now that's from the original survey, right?
From the original 1849 survey. And that's the last point right there. And then it goes along the creek to the end of the county.
Now Bruce, for clarification, you tell the commissioners that, show them what is in, using your marker there, what is taxed by orange right now.
In this area right here, everything that's taxed by Alamance is in green.
And the rest is taxed by orange.
That's all in orange.
So if the line is moved where the purple dot is, the purple line, everything to the left of that line will be taxed by Alamance. Everything to the right will be taxed by orange. Down here at the bottom of the green patch, currently taxed by Alamance, it's right there. Would be, did you show Cane Creek right there?
Yes, that's Cane Creek right there.
Where the curve is, yeah, right there. That would then be taxed by orange, right?
Everything to the east.
I've been able to determine, it's about, I think about 900 acres would go into Alamance County's tax space, about 300 acres would go out of Alamance and into Orange County.
Yeah, it's about 400. Acreage going toward Alamance.
Which point was the Hebron Church?
It's a mark. Slide, two slides back.
Did you go to that one? Let me take a look. I want to know that one.
I'll show you real quick. I set up the GIS here real quickly. Church, we talked about that. This is the point right here with the USGS line.
Right.
This Orange County's line. If you go to Cane Creek, if you turn off the aerials and turn on the Alamance County parcels and zoom out, this is really the only way I can do it. As you zoom up, you can see what we were talking about, the in and out of the county, the USGS, North Carolina Geodetic Survey line. As you head north from the south, it kind of converges and crosses over in Nevin, and the orange line comes over to the right. So the northern section of the county will lose a little, and the southern section we gain. Do you have any more questions with this map at all?
Seems to be fairly close until we get towards the southern part.
Yeah. And the last slide we have was also just a quick update on Guilford County, because we've been meeting with them as well. They are, North Carolina Geodetic Survey, still identifying points and doing research. They came by here on March 31st to show us where they were. Once they have those points, they will send this to us and we'll do another presentation to the board. Initial results, what I could see was similar, that they was following our line pretty closely. That particular project has put into the next fiscal year, starting July 1st, by North Carolina Geodetic Survey. Once the points have been established, again, and delivered to us, we'll present another those findings as well. So you have any questions?
How many residences are we looking at, houses, on the Orange County, Alamance County?
I did some figures this afternoon. And I talked about last time, it was about 115 homes or businesses. I took the aerial photos, turned them on, and kind of went up and down. I mean, you can do lots of methods, but in about 49 of those in Alamance that were going to go to Orange, and 69 of those that were Orange that would go in Alamance. So 20 home or business gain for Orange, and we talked about the acreage, about 413 acreage shift toward Alamance. Those rough numbers, but I did that this afternoon just in case you asked that question.
I think the encouraging thing to remember is it follows the survey. Mr. Lee here was a surveyor that went out there and actually found points, 10 of them on the Alamance line, and about 30 on the Guilford Alamance line. Is that correct?
Probably so, yeah.
So it's matching up very well.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we were hoping it would.
Yes. Yeah. I think it did. Essentially what we thought we would find.
I called Mr. Thompson many, many times to make sure that what we were doing was based on, you know, previous maps, previous surveys, and so they've been very, very, very helpful and worked very hard in this process. So
what are the prospects that Orange is going to go along with this?
They had a sheet they delivered to their board explaining kind of an update, and they are going to meet in May over this, having the same kind of meeting as we are. So we're hopeful that we're going to be going forward.
There was some discussion back in a case back in 2003, the Childers case in Orange County, and the staff in Orange at that time, I found some documentation where they had agreed that the USGS line was the most accurate line, and I think that's what we found in our results. Do you agree, Mr. Lee?
That's what we're finding. It's most closely follows the 1849 survey at the points that we could identify.
Actually, there was a lawsuit in the Superior Court in Orange County found that as a fact and ruled that the USGS line was the line. The county did not even answer that lawsuit, and the plaintiff in it was trying to show that he was in Alamance County, and the court went along with it and made that finding. I think legally they're probably bound by that line.
What's our next step, Bruce?
They are going to well, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think what we'll do is proceed to a final survey.
Correct. We'll wait till we'll see what results of Orange County's meeting, and then if both counties agree with our results, we'll perform the survey and bring both counties a preliminary plat for you to review. And then the statute requires you agree to the plat, that you have a resolution accepting the survey. We'll modify the plat. The law requires we put that ratification on the plat and then come back at final plat. And once it's recorded, then the process will be completed.
As far as the survey goes, and then I think what we'll have to do is enter into some type of agreement with the school boards to grandfather people in that might have to switch schools. And we'll work out an agreement with EMS and the voting issues, I believe, will work themselves out. Shouldn't be. I think once we jump this hurdle, that'll be the biggest part of it.
Okay. So there's no action we need to take.
What we wanted to do was just give you an update and get you a feel for how you felt about the survey result, the preliminary result. They're going to go ahead with their work. We are going to have, what would you say, 20-some properties in issue that we are taxing now that will be in Orange County. And, of course, they'll have a number of properties that they're taxing that will be in Alamance County. So those are the sticking points.
49 and 69.
Difference of 20. Right. So those are the sticking points that will work out. But I think if we get this line done, I don't see how they can argue with it. As Mr. Smith said, they've got a court case where they've agreed that the USGS line is the line.
Mr. Chairman, it might be good if the board would give these gentlemen a consensus how you feel as they proceed, rather than any vote. But if you have a consensus, you might be able to relay to them. I think it would help them. Okay.
Roughly 13 years ago, you remember when we were down in Hillsboro, you and I were on two on the board here. What were they claiming then? Basically what we're seeing now that they're claiming?
And this has been, as Tim mentioned, going on for several years, a lot longer with Orange County than it has with Guilford County. It seems like we may be coming to a conclusion on this issue with both counties. And I'm pleased with the progress that we've made to this point and pleased with the results of the initial survey.
Well, there'll be a public hearing at some time. These people that are going to be displaced from the respective counties, will they have opportunity to come and speak?
We'll have to pass a resolution to ratify the survey. And before we pass that, or at that meeting, I suppose you can hear from the residents. But the newspaper's already called about it today. The TV folks have called about it. So I think the word will get out. And of course, these maps are now public record. The preliminary maps are now public record. So people can see what properties will be affected. And I think between now and June 30th.
Right. Field work should be finished by June 15th, and then we'll wrap up by June 30th.
We should have more than enough time by then to field any concerns that we have from our citizens.
And I think we've indicated all along that we involve the public in the process. So I think that would be good. Are we in consensus that we should proceed?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'll make the motion that we do.
Okay. Second.
A motion is second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank y'all.
Okay, next we have the Terry Glass is going to give us an update on the workforce development annual report.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
I'd like to appreciate say thank you for the opportunity to present this report. Once again, I'm Terry Glass. I'm representing the Regional Partnership Workforce Development Board. The Workforce Development Board's purpose is to oversee the actions of the Regional Partnership, which consists of Alamance, Orange, and Randolph counties. They administer the Workforce Investment Act, or from here on out, WIA. All of you have a copy of the report. Feel free to look through it at your leisure. During 2006-2007, Alamance JobLink, Employment Security Commission, and Building Futures, which is a youth services program, provided the following services. The JobLink Rapid Response Team provided services and information to the employees of several companies that were affected by plant closures, including Buckhorn Rubber Product, Kitty, Culp Weaving, and Centritel. JobLink, the Employment Security Commission, and various partners have held multiple job fairs throughout the year to help the unemployed find employment opportunities. JobLink, with the help of Time Warner, produces a weekly JobLink Today show, which airs on the Public Access Channel every Wednesday at 6 p.m. And this, once again, is another opportunity for the unemployed to see what services are available to them. I will state that in Alamance County, we are the only one who produces this show. Building Futures, which is the youth program, has undertook several different youth programs, among them removing gang graffiti, multiple field trips to businesses to introduce our youth to various career options. Some budget numbers, very roughly, total budget for the regional partnership is $2.6 million. Alamance County received almost $825,000 of this. Of the three counties, we received the largest share of this budget. We have a mandate to co-locate the JobLink and Employment Security Commission in the same facilities, the reason being to provide a single point of service for the unemployed. Of the three counties, Alamance County is the only one who has accomplished this. Gentlemen, I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Terry.
You might have any questions of Terry while he's here? Okay. Thanks for the report. Next on the agenda is our insurance committee recommendations. Ms. Head.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
I mailed to each of you a packet. I think you should have gotten it sometime this week so that you would have the information prior to our presentation tonight, so the information would not be cold to you. So I did send that out. And this evening, I have a number of representatives here. I have Steve Cole, who's here, who is our Alamance County insurance broker. I have Robert Rath, who is with WellPath. And I also have Peter Chauncey, who is with WellPath. They have been instrumental in helping the county propose this program that I'm getting ready. Actually, they will present after I kind of give the reasonings for why we want to do this. This is the request that's coming from the Alamance County Insurance Committee, and we request the approval on the following matter. As you all well know, Alamance County for many years has provided medical coverage to all retired employees. Thus, this is a benefit that it's rarely offered by many corporations and organizations today. After clearly examination of our current medical costs and through the recommendation of our insurance broker, effective July 1, 2008, the Alamance County Insurance Committee is requesting that the current benefit program for retired employees over the age of 65 is changed to a user-friendly plan for this population. And when I speak of user-friendly, what I mean is if this plan is proposed, they will only have one plan. Right now, individuals who are over the age of 65 have Medicare, and then this particular plan that Alamance County offers is secondary. And what I'm seeing in my office is it's an administrative nightmare because for the older population, they don't know what part is primary and what part is secondary, and this proposed plan will alleviate all that. We're roughly talking about 239 Alamance County employees that will fall in this age group. Presently, as the Medicaid plan is today, medical plan is today for retirees over the age of 65. As I stated, Alamance County plan is secondary and Medicaid is primary. And again, this process provides an administrative nightmare for these individuals. The justification for this request is due to the cost savings that the new benefit plan will generate for Alamance County. When examining prescription drug costs alone for this population of employees, last year drug costs were approximately $921,000. The proposed program that WellPath will present will transfer the burden of drug costs back to WellPath, thus yielding a cost savings in this area for the county. The cost to transfer the retirees to the fully insured program offered by WellPath should cost approximately $300,000. This cost combined with drug savings should yield a minimum savings to Alamance County of roughly $600,000. Understanding that this request, if approved, this will be a change for these individuals that are in this targeted population. Thus, the Human Resources Department of Alamance County, Steve Cole, our insurance broker, and WellPath have engaged in a partnership and is committed to ensuring this process is handled professionally, accurate, and an accurate manner to ensure this is a true smooth transition for those employees who will be affected with this change. At this time, I'm going to have Steve come up if there are any questions currently about the cost savings that this plan will yield, because this is, he was the one who provided those numbers for me. Then I will have Robert and Peter come up, and they know they only have 10 minutes, I already told them. And I will have Robert and Peter come up, and they will address any questions that you all may have. And actually what Robert is going to do, Robert has actually had, he has a sheet which will actually show you what the current retiree who's the over the age of 65 has and what the new plan, what the new proposed plan will look like. So I'm going to ask them to come up, and I'm going to sit down.
Thank you, Joyce.
Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. How are you?
Good evening.
Probably the best thing to do, Robert, is just go ahead and pass out these benefit comparison sheets.
Robert, can you use them?
Yeah. I guess the biggest thing about the plan itself, besides trying to save money for the county, is this actually is going to give a better benefit to the retirees. I think after Robert goes over the benefit summary sheet, you'll see why. Robert, you want to go through this?
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
What I'll do is I'll just kind of walk you guys through a comparison of what Alamance County retirees currently have as their benefits versus what we're proposing with the Advantra Retiree Solution 1 that you see in the second column. In the first column, you'll see currently the retirees have a $300 deductible. Moving that over to the Retiree Solution through Advantra, which is the division of Coventry Healthcare that will administer this private fee-for-service plan, members would not have a yearly deductible. Going down the line, you can see that currently the retiree benefit plan has $50,000 lifetime maximum, whereas this plan does not have a lifetime maximum on it. If you go on down, the major benefits are the ones that I outlined here, things like inpatient and outpatient hospitalization and surgeries, skilled nursing facility, outpatient services, and your office visits. Currently, the members are having to meet their yearly deductible and then pay a coinsurance of 20% on whatever the WellPath allowed amount is. Under the new plan, in conjunction with Medicare A and B that would be transferred over to the private fee-for-service plan, the member would not have any liability. So it effectively minimizes or eliminates most of the members out of pocket for the most used services. Another big one is your diagnostic tests, your x-rays and labs. With those, you don't have any copay at all under the new plan. Under the current plan, the member still does have to meet their deductible and their coinsurance. You know, preventative is a big push that we all are doing to get our population out, and especially so for those that are, you know, in the retiree categories. And under this plan, there's a whole range of preventative items that don't have any out-of-pocket cost, whereas the current plan has a $150 yearly limit on those services. If you move on down, there's other things that are included in this plan in addition to what the member currently has under the Alamance County Retiree Plan. In addition, this plan will offer the member a vision benefit, a $100 hardware allowance per year, a $20 copay for a routine exam. It would also offer 50% coverage for their dental cleanings. And also there's wellness programs built in, gym memberships, written materials, an enhanced disease management programs that are more focused to that age group. And at the bottom you'll see the out-of-pocket maximum, and that's one of the key items, is it's only $1,000 under the retiree plan that's being proposed. Currently there's a $2,000 out-of-pocket maximum. So that limits the liability further. If you move on down, the prescription drugs, obviously a big concern to a lot of people. Currently, the system that Alamance County has set up is there's a yearly $100 deductible, and then depending on what tier the medication falls in, the member pays either a 10% coinsurance, a 20% coinsurance, or a 30% coinsurance. Generally, the more expensive the medication, the more expensive the coinsurance. The prescription plan, which it works in conjunction with Medicare Part D, that plan that we're proposing to go along with the medical plan has a flat copay for most items. There's a $25 copay for your second tier, a $55 copay for your third tier, and generics do not have a copay. So members, that helps to steer people to the most cost-effective solution as well, and talk to their doctors about generic usage. In addition, whereas right now a member trying to get maintenance medications for a 90-day supply would just pay their coinsurance, there's no incentive to get a maintenance medication for a 90-day supply. You can do that for two copays under the proposed plan. There is something a little different in the prescription plan. Under Medicare Part D, you might have heard of a donut hole. There is a donut hole in the coverage that Alamance, what we've proposed, there's a buy-up to that to help minimize that. But the donut hole is basically once your medical expenses for prescriptions exceed $2,510 in a year, which we've run some reports and that's a very minimal amount of people. But under Medicare Part D, which is used in this plan, there is no coverage until you get to the catastrophic level of $4,050. The county has included in the cost a buy-up plan which will allow the member to get generic medications for $0 throughout that donut hole. So members would still have coverage for tier one medications throughout that donut hole. And then once they did reach the $4,050, members would then have an even more reduced copay for the drugs that they need to get. All drugs are then covered after the $4,050. And it's either $2.25 for generic, $5.60 for the other drugs, or 5%, whichever is greater. And then again, the mail order is two times copay for those as well. Does anyone have any questions about the benefits or the plan itself, how the plan works?
Okay, I have a thing to ask the panel.
Sure.
Spouses,
yes,
of retirees.
Mm-hmm.
How do they fit into this?
Spouses are considered to be a member. These rates that we provided you are per member. So if you currently are over 65 or Medicare eligible under the retiree plan and your spouse is as well, they would be able to join the plan for the same premium that's being proposed to you right now. I know with the county is going to pay for the employee's portion of the premium, but the members would then pay the premium themselves for that. I think the premium is probably approximately a third or maybe a little bit less than what currently the current premiums are. So that would offer a savings as well to the spouse.
Thank you.
And private fee-for-service, the process is that the member basically transfers their Medicare to the insurance company, and the government then subsidizes us by paying us a premium for each person that's on that plan in conjunction for us providing the benefits under our own risk. And the member does have the opportunity or the ability to always go back to traditional Medicare. It's not something that they're locked into for the rest of their life if they go on the plan. So.
This is very complicated. I never have understood health insurance and how it works. But I know that the county needs to come to terms with the cost of retiree health costs. And this is a significant savings to the county and a step in the right direction. And it still gives the retiree
a great benefit.
A great benefit.
probably an enhanced benefit over what they currently had. And, you know, what we were charged with doing was finding a solution to limit the liability on the county, yet still provide as good or better benefits than as what they currently have. And, you know, also offering a network that's not restrictive to the population. So this fits all those pretty nicely.
What period of time will this be good? You know, is it for a year? Is it for the next 5 years?
The rate that's quoted is a 12-month rate. So for the county, it's a group plan, and it's quoted to the county for a 12-month period of time. So the rates are guaranteed for 12 months. Okay.
Any other questions? Okay. I know the other gentleman out there. Do you have any comments as well, Pat?
I'm Peter Chauncey. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for WellPath. And let me say we're very pleased to be the plan administrator for the county's health plan for active employees. And so we're very pleased to be offering this, this opportunity for retirees.
I was impressed with Peter. Downstairs he chose the stairs instead of the elevator. So keep in shape. Keep the health cost low. Any other questions?
I just might want to add, because this approved process is, this is going to be a big transition for 239 people. We've already done this, we're going to be proactive and looking at the number of individuals that we have to provide to do the transition. So actually, we've talked with Robert, and actually we're going to have about 6 meetings, which will be on site here. We'll send the retirees the invitation to the meetings, so they'll know where the meetings are. We'll have designated times for them to attend the meetings. They can receive education. What's going to happen, because it's going to be effective July 1. So I wanted to go ahead and get it in place, so if they had any questions, this comes July 1, it's going to be a shock to them. So my staff, as well as Peter and his, I mean, Robert and his staff, has offered to go ahead and help us. So we already started the ball moving on hopefully going and getting these meetings started. We're looking at about the first week in May. And those retirees who do not live here, Robert's group will be contacting them via or whatever method they need to get, make sure that they're educated and they understand. We want to be a very smooth transition.
Have you signed me up, sucked in?
No, I have.
Check.
So after 12 months, next year will be based on the claims. The total cost of claims as far as the insurance?
It would, and it would also be based on what the government is then doing with the subsidy. So I think over the past few years it hasn't changed very much.
No, the revenue change has been on the order of 4% for this year, and I think it'll be about the same.
I think all health plans are basically a 12-month plan, and rebidded and whatnot, repriced every 7 months. Yep.
And you know, one of the good benefits about this plan is the fact that instead of a dental card, a vision card, a prescription card, a medical card, and all four, and Medicare, and customer services for each, this would all be one point of contact for them. So, you know, that's one of the benefits that we see in moving that population as well.
This stated minimum savings of $600,000, will that be reflected in this year's, next year's budget?
Already is, yes.
Already factored
in. Did they spend my money?
Or lack thereof.
Exactly.
Any other questions? You have a motion to accept this?
Motion.
Second.
Motion second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Next, budget amendment number 140, the health department. Evening.
Good evening. How are you this evening?
Fine.
Quickly, we have a budget amendment with the health department. It is an agreement between the Alamance Partnership for Children to adjust the salary for our child care consultant due to some things that were not factored in, cost of living expense, and some travel and some desktop supplies, and it is not local. There's no local money in it. It comes directly from Alamance Partnership for Children.
Okay. Any questions? Do we have a motion to accept the amendment? Or a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Manager?
Yes, sir. I want to report to you on the chemical issue that we had several weeks ago. Our latest report this morning was that the chemical has been reduced to less than 200,000 pounds. As you'll recall, it was up close to 1 million pounds at the time of the inspection, and the company has assured us they'll be below the 100,000 pounds by the deadline of April 30. Secondly, I gave you a packet, or actually Amy prepared a packet of that will be included in the budget, of course, but you wanted some revenue figures, and the projected revenue figures are in there. If you have any problem deciphering or ciphering it, just call us and we'll be glad to explain them to you. But the total revenue, projected revenue figure, I think is $127 million, thereabouts. And with that in mind, I will be presenting the budget message to you at the next meeting, which is May 5, and that is a morning meeting.
These figures are through the first three quarters.
Yes, sir.
Any idea what maybe you're going to recommend to us to look at?
I do have a preliminary budget to present, Commissioner, and at this point, it does not include any tax increase. I can't say that that'll be the final one because we've got probably 10 days before we need to start printing it up and still going over and crunching figures and hoping maybe we'll find some more revenue somewhere.
If we can, David's going to present the budget to us on the first Monday in May, and we think about maybe going ahead and scheduling the public hearing on the budget the second meeting in May.
When do we usually do it? We usually do it on the first Monday in June, don't we?
Normally.
Mm-hmm. We used to flip-flop that meeting.
Okay.
But I was thinking if we have the public hearing and we don't adopt the budget that night, then we have the first Monday in June to do that. So right. Since the second Monday is a night meeting, have the public hearing then. The second meeting in May.
Okay.
And then that, if we don't adopt it then we do it maybe the first meeting in June, and we can schedule that as a night meeting if we want to flip.
Right, right. Give us time to work things out.
Yeah.
If need be.
Yes.
Okay.
Judge, can you just briefly tell us what's going on with the mill site on 49 South and the assessment, the $75,000 assessment, cleanup, just to study? Just briefly.
The Belmont?
Yes, sir.
The grant we got is the first stage in trying to get that place cleaned up. I think I probably have gotten inquiries about it for the last 12 years, at least one a year, neighbors wanting the county to do something about it, and this is the first step. Jason is here. He can probably tell you a little more about it. Hopefully we'll get another grant for the second step, and hopefully we can get one for the final cleanup also. Now, mind you, that we're just talking about where the old mill is. There are some other areas in Belmont that we need to address also at some point. There are some big old water tanks up on the hill that are very dangerous right now. This property is owned by a defunct corporation, and the county could have foreclosed for taxes on that and taken possession, but I felt we didn't want that responsibility. So now we're trying to get some grants to help clean the mill up first, without having the to use tax money, local tax money, to clean it up. And this is the first step, and I think it's a good first step.
And they're 10 years behind on taxes.
Yes. Yes, sir.
They would probably like for somebody to take that piece of property, wouldn't they?
Well, yes, they wanted us to back, say, 10 years ago, but I didn't think it was feasible at that time because of the, this test will let us know, the first step will let us know if that soil is contaminated. We think that it is, we think there's oil in it, but we don't know for sure, so it'll help us find out about that.
Yeah, based on the materials that were produced in that mill, there's reason to believe there may be some contamination on the site. Mr. Smith was saying with oil on the site. This particular grant is for environmental assessment, for phase one and a phase two assessment, as well as a structural analysis for redevelopment, if it can be redeveloped. So that's basically what this particular grant is for. It's a $95,000 grant. There was no local match in that or anything. And as Mr. Smith was saying, after the phase one and phase two assessment is done, then there are some cleanup grants that are available as well to actually do the cleanup on the site. But this will just evaluate and let us see exactly what the extent of contamination is.
No paper trails leading back to anybody as far as ownership.
The corporation and the primary individual who ran that corporation, but being a corporation, you know, there's no way to go and get some money from them. It's a defunct corporation.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anything else, Mr. Smith?
No, sir. That's all, Mr. Chair.
Okay. We're down to the consent agenda. Does any commissioner like to pull one of the three items out for discussion?
I'd like to pull out B. Please.
Okay. Pull B. I'll make a motion that we approve items A and C. We have a second?
Second.
Any discussion on those? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Item B.
Okay. I was concerned on item B, and we have stated in here General Statute 143-129. And it's talking about repair work requiring the estimated expenditure of public money in an amount equal to or more than $500,000, or purchase of apparatus, supplies, materials, or equipment requiring an estimated expenditure of public money in an amount equal to or more than $90,000 may be performed. And it goes on down. In the second paragraph of this, it talks about a person having the authority to approve this for $500,000 or $90,000, and it kind of stuck with me. I felt like that's an awful large amount of money for one person to be responsible for, and I'd like to reduce that to not more than $50,000 in each case.
That's state law, isn't it?
Yeah, that's state law, and all this is doing is giving the county the opportunity, if we want to, either advertising it in the newspaper and or advertising it on the internet. That's all this is doing.
That's just covering one area. That would be the max if you had other concerns. But
well, it does say in here that, you know, it doesn't have to be $500,000 or $90,000. It could be anything that the right. governing body right. Suggests.
So we're specifying here electronic advertisement for contracts.
I understand that.
That always comes before the board anyway, before we have the sales.
Okay, any other discussion
the
on that?
Due.
Ma'am?
The bid's due.
Yes.
Okay. Any other discussion? We have a motion to accept item B.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion second. Any discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Aye. I have to oppose.
Okay. Motion carries 4-1. Any commissioners have any announcements?
I've got two questions. One scenario I'd like to bring up to the board, and one question I have. At our budget retreat, we had a facilities cost estimates sheet given to us, and I think we were all burned out a little bit as far as questions we were asking, but who prepared these estimates?
Richard Hill did.
Richard did?
Yes.
Okay. We're not officially using that agency that we had. Tim, you remember that?
Johnson Controls.
Johnson Controls.
Yeah.
No, sir.
So we're not in, we don't have a contract with them.
No, sir.
Okay. That's my first point. This is something that I don't know how many of you saw it. I don't know if it's something we can entertain or not. Maybe too late for this year, but you know, there's always another year. But Davidson County was recognized in the National County Commissioner Association newspaper back in March for their success that they're claiming with performance-based budgeting at the county level. And I don't know how many of you saw that article or not. I saw it and I lost the paper, so I had to call the County Commissioner Association. So they faxed this to us today, and you've got it there in front of you with the yellow marking across of it. But it appears that it is a process done much in business where you attach goals, and if you don't meet your goals, you don't receive certain rewards. If you meet your goals or exceed them, you get bonuses and so forth. But in the opening paragraph here, it says that their department saved almost $2 million last year and banked $1.5 million for future needs. And it's just government doing performance-based budgeting. And what do we have any idea if that's something we could look into? Or
oh yes, sir, we can look into it. I think we saved what and added to our fund balance how much last year?
1.2.
We mm-hmm. saved 1.2 last year, right. and added that to the fund balance,
right.
But I've always felt that a performance type basis was a good idea. I agree with you.
I'm not familiar with this that much. Larry, had you heard them talk about me?
No, I'm not that familiar with Davidson County, but I know the Social Services Department instituted something along that line a few years since I've been on the board.
5 years.
Along that line where they set up specific goals for county, I mean for their departments to meet, mm-hmm. to increase efficiency and provide better customer service. So I think it's a good idea. I think it's something to take a little while to implement.
Yeah.
I don't think we could do it probably this budget
right.
year, but the next budget year would be something I think that would be worth studying.
Right. I called their finance person is Jane Kiker. She's always very accessible, and I called her, and evidently she's out today, but she didn't call me back. But I would like for us to try to explore possibly some of the angles that they pursued,
mm-hmm.
maybe that we're not. If it's good, maybe we can look at it.
Yep.
If not, we'll just continue on.
I think it's a good suggestion. Okay, any other notes?
I do have one question. I'm sorry the sheriff is not here tonight. Maybe this is a question for David or Amy. When was the last time the federal government reimbursed the county for federal detainees?
Billed?
Reimbursed the county for federal detainees.
Well, paid us what we
exactly.
bill them for. We stay about 2 months behind.
It's approximately 2 months
It's about
behind.
A two-month turnaround, Commissioner.
Two months.
Yes, sir. And quite frankly, the Marshal Service pays faster than ICE does. But I'd say 30 to 60 days they usually pay.
Do you think it would be possible for the commissioners, possibly even the newspaper, to get a list of all federal deposits for illegals from April 1st, I think, when the detention center opened? Through March 1st of this year.
The revenue we've received?
Yes, sir.
Sure, we can get that.
Maybe on a quarterly basis?
Terry Johnson gave it to me for, I think, the current fiscal year.
Did he?
The answer is yes.
Then it's possible. I think it'd be interesting to see how that does come in.
I think it'd be real interesting to see how well it's working for us.
Absolutely.
In more ways than one.
Absolutely.
Some people use the slowness. This was an approach. I wasn't going to mention it, obviously, but I will respond. Down in Chapel Hill, April the 6th, they had a seminar, but there were several things discussed, and one of the angles was definitely used as a negative, the degree of which the money comes in. And it's obvious it won't come in the very week you bill them and so forth and so on, but it's hardly a, it's a weak straw that people are grasping for to make a negative towards the program. And
no, I don't think it's that, Tim. It's that.
Well, I just gave my response. And
the government's very quick to collect, but very slow to pay out.
Yeah. Isn't that the truth?
Yes, sir.
We got a large bureaucracy.
Well, you know, 287G, it looks like every county might get to it, which is a good thing. But, you know, when you look at the program and that occurring, the sheriff was wise in that he keeps the U.S. Marshals prisoners. And if I'm not mistaken, Judge, we've got more of them than we have folks in the 287G program.
Yes,
and
sir.
Have for quite a while now.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other comments, discussion? If not, meeting adjourned. Thank you.
Okay, I just thought it'd be interesting to all.
Oh, I bet it is.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioner's website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.